So let me welcome everybody. I'm Alan Barrett, I'm director of the ESRI, and it's a great pleasure to welcome everybody here today for the 2018 Geary lecture. So I think a lot of you will know this. This is the annual lecture that the Institute holds, named after our founding director, Dr. Roy Geary. For people who don't know, I'm just going to read out a small couple of sentences from my former colleague and now deceased Dennis Knift. So talking about Roy Geary, Dennis noted that Geary was a great Irish scientist whose research in mathematical statistics, demography, national accounting and economics is world famous. Okay, most of us in this room, if we sort of did anything important in one area, you'd be feeling good. But Geary wrote across those remarkable range of areas. So much of his prolific outlook was written during a career not as an academic, but as a statistician working in the Irish civil service. So again, it's one of the most remarkable things about Geary that he has this incredible academic output, but never really had a position in a university. And then alongside his theoretical achievements, he contributed enormously to the development of official statistics during the first 40 years of the state while working as director of the Central Statistics Office. So he was the founding director of the Central Statistics Office in 1949. And then he also played a critical role in establishing the reputation of the ESRI, again as director. So he was the founding director of the Institute in 1960. And a lot of people would argue if Whittaker had not had the good sense to appoint somebody of Geary's status, it might have been impossible, basically, for the ESRI to try and create the academic reputation that it was able to do. So on a day like today, I always sort of take this opportunity to sort of say, this will sound sort of slightly religious in some ways, but I always think it's a good opportunity for ESRI people and our stakeholder community just to sort of take the opportunity to remind ourselves that really we're still trying to pursue what Geary would have urged, and that's producing high quality research using high quality data, all with a view to informing policy. That's what he set out to do when the Institute was created in 1960, and that's essentially what we're still trying to do. So it's a real pleasure to welcome to the Institute some of Roy's family. So Roy's grandson, Roy Jr., is here, not quite junior, is here in the front row. And also we've got the grandsons, great-grandsons rather, are here today, Connor and Kevin. So for many years, Roy's daughter, Clodagh, visited us. I believe she's not so well today. We'd like to pass on our very best wishes to her, but it is really, really great to have a Geary presence here for the lecture. Okay, so now let me talk a little bit about today's lecturer, who is, of course, Professor Philip Lane, Governor of the Central Bank of Ireland, and the Whately Professor of Political Economy at Trinity College Dublin. We're breaking with tradition ever so slightly. It is normally the case that the Geary lecturers have been eminent sociologists or economists from off the island of Ireland. But this year I was strolling around somewhere, looked across the river and thought, well, we were rather eminent economists not so far away, and wouldn't it be a good idea to ask Philip to come and give today's lecture? So breaking with the outside the island tradition, but obviously not breaking with the eminent economist tradition, or sociologist. I think most of you, again, will be familiar with Philip's career. Did his undergraduate in Trinity College, a year behind me. PhD in Harvard, spent some time at Columbia after that, and then came back to Trinity where he rose to be the Whately Professor. He has a remarkable academic output. I'm not going to list all his papers, but I think that the one summary I'll just give on this is that he was awarded the Gold Medal in the Social Sciences by the Royal Irish Academy in 2015, which is amongst their most sort of prestigious awards. Of course, the interesting thing about Philip is a number of years ago, a bit like Geary, he basically brought himself into public service, taking over the role as governor of the central bank and doing what is somewhat unusual, making the move from academia into public service. But I think it's just we're remarkably fortunate that somebody of his standing was in a position to take over that important role. So before handing over, sorry for embarrassing you now, Philip, but you're probably used to this. I think one of the reasons I was delighted that Philip would do this is that, without a doubt, Geary was the outstanding economist, Irish economist of his generation, and I think we would all agree that Philip is the outstanding Irish economist, certainly of my generation, so I do think it's remarkably fitting that he's here today to talk to us. So with that, I'll hand over to Professor Philip Lane.
Thank you, Alan. It's indeed an honour to be invited to deliver the Geary Lecture, and especially in the presence of his grandson and great-grandsons, and also in the presence of, looking around the room, former students, colleagues, and also many people who have played such a big role in the Irish social sciences over the years. By the way, before I get any further, I know ESRI, we're talking about, is very strong in behavioral economics and psychology and so on. But I urge the people at the back of the room to break the psychological taboo of sitting in the front row, because we do have 8 or 9 seats up here, and it's, you know, you should really, there always has to be someone in the front row, so. Okay, let me emphasize that, as Alan said, Roy Geary was really, you know, such a leader in developing social sciences through his own research and also through his leadership roles at the CSO and at the ESRI, and maybe most relevant for what, some of what I'm going to talk about today, through his role as head of the National Cancer Division at the UN Statistical Office from 1957 to 1960. So the measurement of national accounts is obviously, for anyone who knows me, and obviously some people in the room, even though some people might say it's an arcane topic, you know, it's very important that we measure properly. Let me say also that the Geary Lecture, you know, since it was set up in the mid-60s, has proven to be a very important conduit for the discussion of important topics in the social sciences. The ESRI, I think, to its credit, has done the work of scanning in old Geary Lectures. And in fact, when I was preparing today's talk, I was looking at 2 Geary Lectures in particular. The 21st Geary Lecture by Rudy Dornbush, and the 24th Geary Lecture by John Dunning. In fact, I was here, you know, as an undergrad. I came along, I think it was 1990 or 91, to listen to Rudy Dornbush. And that was, I don't know who else here, but it's such an impressive occasion. And in fact, I'm pretty sure I'm remembering correctly that my predecessor, Morris Doyle, and some other senior central bank officials came along to listen. And his topic that day was European monetary integration. And this is like 8 or 9 years ahead of the euro, and I'll come back to that later on. And the John Dunning lecture, I wasn't here, but in reading it, it's box fresh. You could read it today. It's all about the importance of high quality national policy making if a country is to take advantage of the opportunities of globalization and avoid the pitfalls. So really, I think we tend to have a short shelf life in social sciences where you only look at things that just came out. But actually, looking back in time is important. Let me also mention with Roy Geary is that in addition to being very prolific throughout his life, there's an interesting data point, which is a large fraction of his total publications came after he was 65. So for what's politely called in the bureaucracy, later stage researchers like Alan and myself, I don't think that the window is closed on our, so I think that's important inspiration. Let me also mention, of course, my links to the ESRI. I was on the, beyond coming to many events over the years, I was on the council here from 09 to 2015. And let me, and even the long, you know, Alan mentioned, is founded in 1960. But really the interesting characteristic of the ESRI is it's the home to long-term research. So we have various models here, various data sets here, where no individual, no university can play that role. You have to have an institution like the ESRI as kind of permanent resource, the holder of that knowledge about the Irish economy and Irish society. Okay, so let me turn to what I want to talk about. And what I want to talk about is the implications of globalization for the Irish economy. Now, that's a big topic. So in fact, what I'm going to talk about, and maybe no surprise given my research career and given my current position, is I want to focus in on the implications for macro financial policy. So of course, there's implications for climate change, environmental sustainability. How do we solve global problems like climate change, the inequalities in the world, development, all of those things. All relevant, but I won't try and tackle those today. What I do want to tackle is the macro financial dimension. And so when you think about that, really, In the economics literature, there's really what I call a trio of trilemmas that matter. So one trilemma is the monetary trilemma, which says only two of the following three are simultaneously possible: having an independent monetary policy, having a stable exchange rate, and having unrestricted international capital mobility. So if we think about globalization as a commitment to having open capital markets, you have a choice between having a stable exchange rate and having an independent monetary policy. So that's well known, that's Mundell-Fleming, it's been talked about many times. And as you know, if you like, the innovation in the last 20 years ago was in Europe, instead of saying, well, this is a choice between a float and a pegged exchange rate, a new choice was introduced with the euro, which is essentially having a share, by sharing sovereignty, you can have a shared monetary policy across the euro area. And I think that's very interesting. It gives you an extra dimension. A second relevant trilemma is called the financial trilemma, which says only two of the following three options are possible: a stable financial system, independent national financial policies, and cross-border financial integration. So essentially, and I think we may have some intuitive sense here in this country of this, is again, if you're committed to having open capital markets, you basically have a choice. Do you want financial stability, or do you want national independence in making financial policy? So whether that's capital ratios for banks, supervision, and so on. So that's an interesting issue. And of course, I'll come back later on to the change that's been made to address that recently. And then the third trilemma, which is, of course, has other applications, but it's relevant here, is developed by Danny Roderick. It's called the political economy trilemma, which is, again, you can only have two of the following three options: economic integration, democratic politics, and independence in policymaking. And so again, this is runs through a lot. It runs through the design of the euro. It clearly, I've written the speech, and you can get the speech on the website. I've succeeded in writing the speech without mentioning the B word. But of course, for those of you who want to make that link, clearly that political economy trilemma is very important for thinking about what's going on next door. And of course, coming back to Europe, again, the European approach, which is let's try and smooth this over by sharing sovereignty through development of the European Union, is a way to, and that's the open question, is that delivering in terms of delivering the democratic accountability for the internationalization of policymaking. So let me come back to, given those constraints, what does it mean for policymaking? But before I get to that, I do want to heavily emphasize the point, which is, if you want to think about policymaking, measurement comes first. And globalization, so in other words, even if you know what you want to do in terms of policy, you have a mundane problem, but an important problem, which is, what's going on? And in a globalized world, working out what's going on is not always easy. Because essentially, national accounting struggles with some of the implications of globalization. And let me emphasize, part of it is national accounting, part of it is, if you like, financial data. So understanding balance of payments data, understanding financial system data in a globalized world is not so straightforward. And of course, in this country, we know this because of the large role of multinational firms, and we know this because of the fact we have a really large international financial center here, in addition to the domestic facing financial system. And of course, if you are living in a fog of not knowing what's going on, mistakes can happen. So for example, if you go back and look at the aggregate financial data that the Central Bank of Ireland publishes, or the BIS publishes and so on, it's not clear from the aggregate data what's going on, because it's so dominated by the balance sheets of the IFSC type operations. And this is a problem in the 2000s because people are looking at these data and basically saying, I'm not going to think about Ireland because we know it's the IFSC banks and it's hard to get underneath that. And then in terms of the macro, as we know here, historically all we need to do was focus on gross national income or its cousin gross national product, given that we knew that the net of tax profits of the multinationals created a natural gap between the headline GDP number and domestic income. So what's, we've all been involved in recent years is the fact now the world has got more complicated. We have the increasing importance of a small number of superstar firms in the world economy. So the size of multinationals compared to the world economy has gone up. We have an increasing importance of IP assets in global production. So the ability to move across borders, kind of weightless assets is a factor. And we also have essentially, also with the rise of global production chains, the fact you can combine management expertise in one location with IP assets in a second location and contract manufacturing in a third location just means the ability to chop up economic activity across borders has gone up. So let me emphasize is progress as possible. We know what the CSO has been doing in terms of GNI star and the adjusted current account. The impact of that is when you look at gross national incomes, the adjusted gross national income compared to headline GDP, that constitutes a difference now of 62%. GDP is 62% ahead of GNI star. So if you're trying to think about what's a reasonable way to allocate the income we earn, the answer is going to be very different between GNI star and GDP. And so it's really important, and I think it's been successful here, that I think by and large the system has accepted that, but I think it's going to be an ongoing struggle. And equally with the current account, the headline current account number says we're running this gigantic surplus. The adjusted current account number says we're more or less at zero, close to zero. And of course the message in terms of the dynamics of the economy, is the economy unbalanced and so on, is a very different story here. So we have that. So I think there's been important progress, I'm sure more to come from the CSO on those topics. But let me emphasize also, parallel work is needed in terms of the international balance sheet. So earlier on I mentioned that we have this issue where the headline financial data don't really tell you what's going on. So at the central bank, we've had some work recently. Just in the recent weeks, there was a note put out by Valerie Hertzberg and Vahan Gastayan, which basically says, rather than looking at the current account or the net international investment position, an effective indicator for Ireland is the net external liabilities of domestic banks. So if you zero in on the domestic banks, you get around the problem of the IFSC banks. And in fact, I think that kind of work where you ignore the official data and you construct your own series is I think going to be quite important. So I think that's an important message. And equally, when you think about the international balance sheet of Ireland, it's gigantic. But a lot of it is in and out. You have investment funds raising money overseas, investing overseas. It's in the data, but from the point of view of understanding the local dynamics of the Irish economy, it doesn't really matter. And again, Vahan has been working on this. And if you strip out that kind of in and out work, the balance sheet looks a lot different. It looks a lot smaller. It looks a lot more normal. So really the message there is, I think, I would personally put a high premium on what I would call forensic work. You're digging underneath the headline data, which I appreciate is easier for those inside institutions than for those outside institutions. It's a lot of work. So many people, it's interesting about how the world allocates resources. The amount of allocation to people to do that kind of work, which is important, is not going to be naturally the kind of work that gets research grants and so on, whereas it's quite important. Let me also emphasize is that there's other work going on here and elsewhere, which also leads to a better understanding of what's going on. So for example, there's more and more availability of micro data. So we now have more data on at a securities level. So any given bond, who's holding that bond? So if you want to think about the implications of, let's say there's a default on that bond or its value changes, who's going to be hit? Again, it's big data, it's lots of data. Some of the data is confidential, but again, there are people like Yannick Timmer, one of my former students, Katharina Bergant and Martin Schmitz at the ECB, who are working and showing insights from security level data. Another area which I've worked on is essentially combining data sets. So the official data will tell you how indebted is a country, but it doesn't tell you officially in what currencies are those debts. So it's possible to combine different data sets to come out with numbers about the sensitivity of each country to exchange rate movements. So I was talking to someone earlier on today, you know, if sterling weakens, how much do we care? Of course we care for trade reasons, but is it the case that Irish residents have a lot of wealth tied up in sterling denominated assets? Again, by looking at the micro data, you can get an answer. So all of that is basically, you might say, well, all of that should have been happening, but I think this is fairly recent. Again, like many other areas of economic research, the availability of more detailed data allows more progress to be made. Let me mention also is that another way to think about the data is to combine the national accounts data with what's called the sectoral financial accounts. So here, both the CSO in terms of the annual accounts and the central bank in terms of quarterly accounts. Now, and you heard headlines last week about the wealth of Irish households, or you might hear about the debts of non-financial corporates and so on. So the interaction between those sectoral accounts and the external accounts, I think a lot of insights can be got from that. So for example, at Trinity, Kian Allen, who's doing his PhD there, has shown essentially that when we think about what drives a current account deficit, in fact, there's very little connection with the household accounts. It is not the case that it's coming from fluctuations in the savings behavior of households. It's mostly coming from the decisions of non-financial corporates and the sovereign. And again, this is something that really, I think, provides a lot of additional insights. So I think there's a lot of progress here. And again, in the written text, I tried to give you more detail about all of that. Anyway, having made that basic point, which is everyone should spend all their time measuring things, let's assume we solved those measurement problems, then the question is how to make policy. And taking into account the trilemmas I talked about earlier on, the monetary trilemma, the financial trilemma, and the political economy trilemma. And here, from a cyclical point of view, the question is, well, why do we care about globalization? And I think there's really a nuanced answer here. And this is why it's important, because some people have very fixed beliefs. They will emphasize some dimensions and forget about other dimensions. So not surprisingly, you might read very strong opinions, for example, about whether the euro is stabilizing or destabilizing, because you can pick and choose. So in terms of thinking about it in general, the basic point here is some parts of globalization lead to amplification. If you have a shock, globalization can make it worse. On the other hand, some parts of globalization act as a dampener. If you have a shock, some other parts of globalization make it less severe. So the question is, in policymaking, is what you want to do is the amplifying mechanisms you want to turn down, the dampening mechanisms you want to turn up. But you need to recognize that it's a nuanced picture. It's not all in one direction. So if you think about it, for example, let's say there's a productivity boost in one economy. In a closed economy, that's going to run out of steam. Once you've employed all the workers, once you've fully utilized all the capital, there's a limit to how much you can grow. In an open economy, the boom can be longer and more dramatic because you can import more capital, you can bring in workers from overseas, and you can raise funding overseas. So in an open economy, you can have these longer booms because you don't just need have access to domestic resources, you have access to foreign resources. But equally, if there's a negative shock, the shock can get more severe because the negative shock can be reinforced by exit. You can have workers leaving, you can have capital leaving, you can have finance leaving. So under that world, globalization means more volatility. Someone once said, sometimes booms get boomier. So you can have boomier booms and you can have more severe recessions. And we have to take that very seriously. On the other hand, there are also dampening mechanisms. And this is why it's a nuanced picture. For example, let's say you have appreciation, you have rising cost pressures at home. One way some firms will get around that is they'll move production overseas. So there's a safety valve of saying, well, you know, this location's getting more expensive, let me switch to overseas production. So a firm may survive by reducing its costs by switching location. It's also the case that there are kind of rescue mechanisms which make recessions less severe. Because in a recession, if there's a decline in domestic costs, you're not just waiting for domestic firms to take advantage, and those domestic firms may be bankrupt, have limited access to credit. You also have access to foreign firms. So foreign firms come in, if there's new entry, new funding from overseas, that can mean that the recession ends more quickly and the recovery happens earlier. And I think you have both dimensions going on in the Irish experience. We definitely had some of the amplification experiences, but we also, it's been visible, we've had some of the dampening dynamics which made the recession finish earlier than some people expected. So I think in thinking about this, we have to recognize both mechanisms are at work, and that's relevant for how we set policy. So let me also mention, by the way, is at a practical level, what I just referred to is a cyclical shock. What happens if there's temporary boost in productivity or something else, which means you have a transient window of rising output. As a practical matter, it's very hard to tell apart what is cyclical and what is a shock to the trend. Because going back to mid-1990s here, if, you know, beyond the far-sighted people of the ESRI, the calculation of how big can the Irish economy possibly be, you know, 10 years from now, most people would have been way off. Because sometimes you can have a trend, a structural improvement in the economy, or a structural reversal, and the policy answer for how to accommodate a trend shock is very different to how to accommodate a cyclical shock. So in other words, as something last week where people say, well, it's terrible news, we're growing quickly, because inevitably booms are followed by busts. That is not the right answer. I mean, you have to think about it. If we're growing quickly because the capacity of the economy has improved, we've kind of looked into structurally strong parts of the world economy, it is not the case that fast growth now inevitably means a recession down the road. And telling that apart is why the very respected areas of economic forecasting and diagnosing what's going on in the economy is so important. And that's, you know, I think very important for our work, and indeed the ESRI work, is what the hell is going on? It's a very important question. So anyway, when you those are the considerations you want to take into account. Let me also say an increasing trend in macro, but I know it's also very evident here at the ESRI, is to recognize this is not just about rational calculations. All of that is also filtered through how people form beliefs. So the people like Andre Schleifer these days are trying to integrate expectations mechanisms into macro models. I know Pete Lund, I think I saw him here somewhere, he has a very nice paper about the beliefs and perceptions of people involved in the boom-bust cycle here in Ireland. Is that also creates possibly, it can create more volatility or can be stabilizing depending on the circumstances. So, turning all of that into policy making, what does that mean? It means, let me go through it. One is, in terms of fiscal policy, is recognizing that if you detect that kind of cyclical volatility, it's so important to have the counterbalance of stabilizing fiscal policy. And if we want to run stabilizing deficits in the recessions, it does mean we need to run this big enough surpluses in the good years to allow for that. It's also the case at various points I've written about the fact you can use time-varying tax rates. So the classic public finance answer is keep tax rates constant. That's the best type of tax rate, is constant. But the reality is you can raise taxes in a boom, lower taxes in a recession is a lever that's particularly important when you no longer have an independent currency. Let me talk also about the other arm of national policymaking here, which is what we call macroprudential policy, which is essentially, rather than being passive in relation to the stability of the financial system, it's important to take actions in the good years to build up capital and reserves in the banks in the good years, in order to make sure that in the downturns, they're not forced into a credit crunch. And this is why we have what's called a counter-cyclical capital buffer, and it's also helped by the mortgage rules that we've implemented. So I think, having said that, and so far I've said the response is fiscal, the response is macroprudential. And by the way, that's true no matter what currency arrangement you have. Pretty much, you know, the UK is using these tools. The US is talking about starting to use the counter-cyclical capital buffer. So far, I've been silent on the currency. So let me come to the currency issue. And the question is, given all of what's going on, is the euro a help or a hindrance to the stability of the national economy? Here, you know, and I think I mentioned earlier on, there's all sorts of strong opinions about. Let me give my balanced opinion, as opposed to the strong opinions some others have. And you can work out for yourself if you have any biases. But there you can go back and look at what I wrote even before the euro came into existence, or before I took on this job. And so the question is, typically it said, well, you've given up an instrument. You've given up the option to devalue in a downturn. Surely that's destabilizing. So some of the issues to think about is, one is, how likely is that versus common shocks? So when you have a common shock like the global financial crisis, a movement in oil prices and so on, the fact that the ECB moves the interest rate for everyone in the euro area means for common shocks, you avoid problems of lack of coordination if we had national currencies. And a second factor is, if we have independent currencies, do we think currencies move in the right direction, or do we think speculators mean that a lot of currency volatility is destabilizing? So by the elimination of national currencies, it eliminates a lot of the noise which is in the exchange rate data. Of course, speculation can still happen to the sovereign bond market, to the bank debt market, and so on. But to the exchange rate market, which is for everyone. Everyone is exposed to currencies. If you think financial shocks are material, that's quite important. Another point of view is that empirically, it's very hard to find evidence that currency devaluation is a unmitigated gain. So recently, in work I did with Livio Stracker at ECB, yes, it does have an effect on output, but as an opposite effect on consumption. Because if you devalue the currency, you're making the population poorer in terms of its purchasing power for imports. That kind of turns the trade effect matters quite a bit. It also depends on the balance sheet, going back to understanding what is the currency exposure in the balance sheet. It depends on who has exposure to foreign currency debt. It's also the case under an independent interest rate, this can have perverse interactions. So for example, let's say in a boom like the mid-2000s, an independent central bank decided to raise interest rates. The question is whether any dampening effect it has on credit would be overwhelmed by hot money coming in response. So country booming plus offering high interest rates, let's put money in. And of course, that's the Icelandic experience, where hot money led to massive appreciation in the mid-2000s. And you might say, well, massive appreciation will cool down the economy. Massive appreciation also means the foreign currency value of domestic property goes up. And if you've risk-taking developers, then they borrow more money. So the risk-taking channel of monetary policy would say, maybe it's not a good idea. And then maybe finally, and maybe fundamentally, the old debate was between a floating exchange rate and a fixed exchange rate. But that doesn't cover the economics of a monetary union. Because with a fixed exchange rate, if there's a speculative attack, you're on your own. Do you have enough foreign currency reserves? Either you do or you don't, but it's on you to defend that. In a common currency area with a common central bank, you can have cross-border liquidity flows. So when money left the Irish system during the crisis, there's a huge inflow from the ECB. So I think in 2010, it's on the order of 55% of GDP came into Ireland through ECB liquidity operations. And that's not a negotiation, that's mechanical. It's how a monetary union works. And so in terms of insurance against financial shocks, being part of the euro area, and I've done this study, others have done this study, comparing members of the euro area compared to, say, Latvia or other countries in Eastern Europe which had a fixed exchange against the euro, the crisis was much less severe for those who had access to ECB liquidity. So I would be an optimist about the euro being sensible for European economies, and that degree of optimism would be reinforced by all that's happened since the crisis. The introduction of the European Stability Mechanism, the clarification of OMT by the ECB, the development of common supervisory approach to financial regulation, such as in banking through the SSM, the introduction of recovery and resolution mechanisms, the activation of macroprudential frameworks, and the strengthening of the European fiscal framework all mean that the euro architecture is a lot more robust than it used to be. Now, I would say also more needs to be done, the completion of banking union, the completion of capital markets union can provide further dampening mechanisms. So for example, one of the big benefits here is we would have more diversified ownership of bank equity and bank contingent debt. So if there's a downturn, the losses are shared overseas. By the way, that's significant already in the Irish case. A lot of the shareholders in the Irish banks were foreign in the mid-2000s, and there was a lot of subordinated debt issues, and there's a big write-down on the subordinated debt. It's also the case, ultimately, it's envisaged that banking union would lead to geographically diversified banking. So what we have had then is concentration risk. The Irish banks just so exposed to Ireland. Whereas if you had a pan-European banking, taking a hit in one country would not be so severe. So really, my assessment is these triple trilemmas, you cannot escape. The monetary trilemma, the financial trilemma, and the political economy trilemma. And typically those are analyzed from an individual country perspective. And the kind of the get around in Europe was to say, we can find intermediate solutions by developing EU-level institutions such as the euro, EU-level institutions such as the European System of Financial Supervision. And then the remaining bit of that is that sustainable from the perspective of the political economy trilemma? So these are big questions about the sustainability of intergovernmental solutions. So remember the ESM, for example, is intergovernmental. The sustainability of the ESM, the sustainability of the European semester in terms of fiscal policy making. So this is why, in the end, even though, of course, the typical economist is often accused of being imperialistic, saying, well, all you need to know is economics. Why should we care about the other social sciences? And absolutely, this is not the case, because knowing what's going to be the future of Europe is very much a question for political science and for sociology, just as much for economics. Because unless you have the alignment between policy making and political economy tensions do arise, as we know. So I think let me stop there, which is again, in speaking to you this afternoon, I've really tried to give you a summary of a kind of more carefully written, but it'd take forever to read the speech. So you can, and we will be tracking the downloads. And if it's only myself clicking on the link, I'll know how much of an impact I made. But I've really tried to make two points here. Is one is a practical point, which is globalization means relying on headline economic or financial data is not adequate. And the response to that is, I think, to step forward as the CSO has done. But I think for researchers, there's a huge opportunity here. And I've tried to cite some of the work in the paper to really uncover what's going on by combining all the different data sets that are available. And the world is drowning in data. The what needs to happen is analytics to look at that data. And then second, I've tried to point out is really the very severe implications of globalization for policymaking. But in fact, I think we should be optimistic that the European approach of internationalizing policymaking at a European level really holds the key. The right answer is not having national policymaking, because there's so many limitations to country by country policymaking. But that's an economic issue for monetary policy. It's an issue for financial policy, and it's an issue for political economy. So let me stop there, Alan, and if anyone has any comments or questions, I'm happy to take them.